Yes, I'm going to walk. Oh, that will keep my way. Oh, child, some of these days. Well, I'm going to walk that milky white way. Oh, some of these days. Well, 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 I'm going to walk up and take up my stand. Gonna join that Christian band. I'm going to walk, whoa, that milky white way. Oh Lord, some of these days. I'm gonna tell my, oh, my mother, howdy, 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 when I get home. Yes, I'm going to tell my mother howdy when I get home. Well, 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 I want to tell my mother hey when I shake mother hand that day. That's when I want, oh, that milky white way, some of these days. I want to meet God the Father and God the Son. Yes, I want to meet God the Father.
Thank you. Oh, Hallelujah. Come on and bless the Lord who's been so good to us. In spite of it all, come on, how do we do it? Come on, bless God. For the things true. We give honor and honor is due to God the Father, the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. To all of these very fine preachers and pastors, men and women of the gospel, we greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus the Christ. I've come for prayer of comfort, and let us go to the throne of grace at this time. Let's pray. Our Father, our God, we come as humble as we know how. First of all, being on record for being forever grateful. So before we ask you for anything, God, we thank you for everything. Thank you, God, for your grace. And thank you for your mercy. God, thank you that even with the storm here and the rain falling, we still got to admit, but you've still been a good God. God, even with sorrow in our hearts and tears flowing down our cheeks, we still have to admit, but you've sure been a good God. So though we may have questions of why, we may have questions of what are you doing, we still trust in you. So God, even though we don't quite understand, can't comprehend what you're doing, we give you honor anyway. We give you glory anyway. So God, now we ask that you come into your house today. Don't let our coming be in vain, but God, meet us here today. For the family needs to feel your presence. The family needs to feel your anointing. The family needs to feel your power today. But God, I can't be just remiss if I would say just the family, but all of us need you. Somebody needs you for one thing and somebody needs you for another. But the reality is, God, we all need you. So God, do what only you can do in this place. Wrap your loving arms of protection around us. Show us the kind of God that you are. That you specialize in turning things around. For you can take our tears of sorrow and turn them into tears of joy. Thank you, God, that even in the midnight season, we can still have enough strength to give you praise. Because we understand that we may endure for one night. But God, we rejoice that joy cometh in the morning. Somebody here needs some joy today, God. Give them joy now in their weeping. Give them joy in their broken heart. Give them joy in their non-understanding. God, we know that you make no mistakes. We know that you're too wise for that. And so God, help us to encourage these family. Help us to encourage his mother and sister, children and cousins and brothers. Help us to encourage the family that we can be able to tell them, for all of us who've been down this road before, we can tell everything gonna be all right. May not look like it right now, but God got a way of turning things for our good. For the both of us who believe in you, Jesus, we know that this is not bye-bye, but this is just see you later. So now, God, move how you want to move. Do what you want to do. As long as you want to, God, we can have your way. And we'll be careful to give your name all the praise and all the glory. It's in the mighty name of Jesus we do pray. And every believer ought to say amen. Yeah.
greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Our scripture lesson, Father, I will be found in the book of Psalms, chapter 90. And it reads, Thou hast been our dwelling places through all generations. Before the mountain was brought forth ever, Thou hast formed the earth of the world. Even from everlasting to everlasting, Thou art God. For all our days are passed away in Thy wrath. We spent our years as a tale that is told. The days of our years are 70 years and 10. And if by reason of strength, they are 80. Yet, in your anger, labor, and sorrow, and it is soon cut off, and we fly away. Who knoweth the power of thy anger? Even according to thy fear, so is thy wrath. So Lord, teach us to number our days. Teach us to number our days so that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. I read to you scripture from Psalm number 90. May God add richly blessed into the reading of His holy word.
We give God the glory. We truly give Him the honor for the great things that He has done for us. 60+ years. He gave us a gift shaped in the form of Lawrence Rowell, my dear childhood friend. And to you, Miss Alberta, to you, Penny and Pam and your children, and the Rowell's grandchildren, we extend our condolences to you from the Tyson family, Lucille children. I'll be reading the New Testaments coming from Romans chapter 8. I'll be reading to the listeners of God's word starting at the 31st verse, where the writer says, what shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for all of us, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Verse 33, who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifies. Who is he that condemned? It is Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also make intercession for us. Verse 35, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Here's a list. Shall it be tribulation, distress, or persecution? Shall it be famine, nakedness, or peril, or sword? Listen to what the writer says in the 36th verse. As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long, big battle. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. You can hear my brother Lawrence saying, for I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities,
nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come.
Yes, sir.
Nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate me from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. May the words of God, may you find them to be comfort to your spirit as you continue to press your way through the days to come. Know that God is your comfort. In him you must put all your trust. God bless you. God bless you.
At this time, there's opportunity for reflections. Conway will come to share in words of reflection class of 7 to 6. And following, after Mr. Conway, there's a musical selection. I want to say, as you prepare for the musical selection, as the eulogy will come, I want to ask that we would pray mightily upon this eulogy. Amen. It's difficult enough as it is to lose someone that you love. And to be able to stand forward and to give the word of God, she's going to be our strength. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
And so I ask that we would, following the reflections of Mr. Calloway and the musical selection, that we would lift her up before the Master. That God would enable her to give a word that would help all of us. Because there's nothing can be said now that will make a determination of the final resting place for Brother Lawrence. But she have an opportunity to share a word with you and I. For we still on our way. At this time, reflection.
Good afternoon, everyone. Pastor Hubb, pastor of our church, other members in the pulpit. To the family of Lawrence Rowell, Lawrence Franklin Rowell. I know we are all deeply sad. So am I. I want to express a few words of sympathy to his family and friends. Lawrence, I met Lawrence at a very young age. When we met, I think we met at East River years ago. And we hooked up right off. We had so much ways of life. You know, Lawrence was Lawrence. You know what I'm saying? And I want you all to know this right here. God works in mysterious ways. About 2 weeks before Lawrence's death, I met him and I talked, we had a long talk. And this is what he told me. He said, you know how he was. I said, Lawrence, we're gonna have a class reunion coming up, man. He said, damn, damn. I said, yeah. I said, you gonna roll with me? He said, yeah, I'll go with you, man. I'll go with you. You know, not knowing that he was setting me up for this day. You know. And you know, like, when I heard that Lawrence had passed, I'm telling you, I haven't slept for days, you know what I'm saying? You know. From one Marine to another, you know, that's how we love one another. Lawrence is just like a brother to me. I want to say from my family, all my sisters and brothers that were not able to attend, my mom who was in the nursing home, they all send their love. But anyway, to his mother, Ms. Burr, you know I love you, Mom. I love you dearly with all my heart. You are my other mother. Other people don't know, but they better not get it twisted. I'm telling you that from the bottom of my heart, nothing I say can help our beloved brother. But maybe a few things can help one of us. I met Lawrence, like I said, then in Hebrew school at very early age. He was funny and love to help form. At a very early age, we joined this church at Big Bethel Baptist Church. We graduated from Americus High School in 1976. All my classmates, you know, I would like to be standing at this time. Lawrence, he was very, very friendly. He was very intelligent. But one thing about Lawrence, if you got him wrong, he'll let you know quick, fast, and hurt. So, Lawrence was a man on a mission. He joined the Marines. He excelled, making the rank of staff sergeant. From his superiors, he received meritorious promotions, outstanding honors, and medals. Lawrence loved his family. Lawrence was not perfect, neither am I. If anyone here without fault, please stand. God loves us all. Knows our hearts and thoughts. Four things in the world that a man got to have. That's faith, wealth, knowledge, and understanding. Lawrence had all four of them, and I knew him because he was raised by both of us. We might swear away from the street, but guess what? We found our way back home. His last word was to me, he said, "Steve, man, I'm cleaning myself up. I ain't gonna be doing that." I said, "Okay, I'll see you around." You know what I'm saying? But anyway, you know, Lawrence was a true friend. You know, I loved him. We was more than friends, we was like brothers. If you swung at Lawrence, you might as well have swung at me. That's the way we rode. You know what I'm saying? So, in closing, you know, I like to just say, I salute my fallen friend. In the Marines, you know, we have a boot camp. And the boot camp is very rough. The only time we have peace is on the sun. And our favorite song is "Sweet Low, Sweet Cherry." So I'm not a saint, but I'm letting you know, I'm gonna put it in words. "Sweet Low, Sweet Cherry." If you get there, before I do, tell all my friends I'm coming too. May God bless you all. Love always. Thanks for coming to this going home celebration. Simplify Dallas, my fallen friend. From one Marine to another, farewell, my fallen friend. You will be truly missed. We love you. God knows best. Thank you all for letting me share.
Come on and give the Lord a hand of praise. For he is truly worthy to be praised. Know that you have to lean on the Lord. Come on now, right now we need to lean on the Lord. We need all of our strength, all of our help comes from the Lord. Lean on me. Guess what?
1976. They remember me because Pam and Lawrence used to take me to school with them because I wasn't in school. And they would take me to school with them, and I thought I was them. So, class of 1976, thank you all so much. Also, Harris and Rowell families, we're going to do a family picture after the committal at the cemetery. So, all of you all, if you don't mind coming back, to be a part of the family picture, and then there are to-go plates for the food, so you all can, you know, take your food. But please come back so that we can have a family picture and something to remember for this day. What else? All of you, as I shared, we thank you for your love, your support, your encouragement, calls, visits, monetary gifts, food donations from everyone. And we truly, truly appreciate you all for that. And just as I did at my brother's funeral, Dad, and here we are again, but just as I did at his funeral, I had some words to share with black men. So I'm going to say something to the black men, and I'm going to say something to the black women. But to the black men, it is so important, your physical health. Not only physical health, we're going to get into mental health in 1 second, but your physical health. It is so important that you go to the doctor once a year. Yes,
amen.
Once a year. I know you don't like your blood being drawn, but go let them draw your blood. It tells a lot about what's going on in your body that you don't know. But go to the doctor once a year. Go to your eye doctor. Go to your dentist. Get your prostate exam. Get all of this stuff done. Okay? Because to me, a lot of our men are dying prematurely, heart attack, stroke, things that could possibly be prevented if you go to the doctor and take care of yourself. Mental health. It's nothing wrong with going to a counselor. Nothing wrong with going to a therapist so that they can walk you through. Because we're so quick that when our physical bodies, oh, I got a headache. Oh, I broke my foot. Oh, my arm hurt. This, that, and the other. You're quick to go to the doctor for that. But our minds and our emotions are fragile. And when we experience traumatic things, We tend to run from that because years ago we used to think mental health, oh, they crazy. We used to think that that is not true. People process traumatic events differently. And it is important that we use the resources, which are counselors and therapists, to help us walk through those things, okay? I'm not ashamed to say I've had my mental health evaluation. I have a therapist and I'm walking through the things that I've experienced. I'm not ashamed to say. Maybe that'll encourage some of you to get your mental health evaluation, okay? So that's to black men and to black women. Now, black women, it is important that we support the men that are in our lives, that we speak life into them. We don't always agree with what they do, how they behave, none of them. But it's important that we pray for them, that we fast, that we put them before the Lord, put them on the altar. There was a song years ago, put them on the altar. It's important that we do that because for a lot of them, what we have may be their saving grace, so to speak. What we have to offer, what we have to pour into them, that encouragement and that unconditional love. So they have a responsibility, but we have an equal responsibility as well. Okay? A couple of memorable things. I'm gonna share some memorable things about Lawrence, then I'm gonna share some funny things. Y'all gonna laugh at the funny stuff. But one of the memorable things, I gave myself a 40th birthday party in a housewarming, and he came, and I was so excited because he said he wasn't going to come, and Pam's husband, Tommy, brought him up, and I had gone to the store, had no idea he was coming, and when I walked in my front door, you can see straight through the kitchen, and he was sitting there, and I just stood there almost in tears, so excited that he came because Dad was there too, and I just wanted all of us to be there. And one of the pictures, you'll see it, Mom is in the middle. Each of us are on her side and she's in the middle. You'll see that that's in my den at my house, and that was at the birthday party. Another memorable thing was when he was stationed in Japan. He sent all of us some really nice gifts, and he brought me a kimono bag. And I want to say it was red, it could have been orange, but it was the cutest little thing, and I would never forget. I was excited, and for whatever reason, he called it a smoking jacket, and I didn't smoke, you know, before I said 4 years old, 5 years old, but that's what he called it. So I was like, you know, my smoking jacket, but later on I found out the proper term, it's a kimono. Eye surgery. I was born with strabismus or cross eyes, and that really bothered him because when I was growing up, I was teased a lot, and he could not stand that. And I remember after he graduated, went off to the military, my mom had already scheduled my eye surgery, and he wanted Mom to make sure there was a picture taken of me so that he could actually see the surgery and my eyes straight. So he was so excited about that. I remember one time some neighbors years ago at the house my mom is in, for whatever reason, and he had some mental health issues, he broke my bedroom window by throwing a beer bottle in it and broke it, and it was extremely cold. So when he broke it, the cold coming in and all of that stuff, Lawrence got whatever he could and fixed it for me. And that was just surprising to me. But he fixed it for me, so that's another memorable thing. Something else, I remember when my first husband died, he came to my husband's funeral, which was a surprise as well. And one thing about Lawrence, he got two suits made when he was in Japan. And that was when he was in his 20s. This man was 50. Still wear the suit. I promise you, he wore the suit to my former husband's funeral. He could still wear him at 50. He stayed the same size, and everybody knew that. I remember one Christmas, we asked him, Thad and I, we were still in high school, we asked him if he would please buy Mom a microwave for Christmas. And I knew he had his stuff going on and what he was doing, but he did. And I won't ever forget the fact that he sacrificed and put that little money aside so that he could do that. And I do remember one final memorable thing. After Thad died, he and I would talk on the phone, and he said, I'm gonna be a better brother to my sisters. So his heart was right. He may not have been able to follow through and carry everything out that he wanted to, but his heart was right. Now the funny stuff. Okay, when my twins graduated from high school, I had a graduation party for them at my house. And my neighbors came over, female neighbors, and all of my neighbors were married, okay, married. who got husbands, all this stuff. Y'all know where I'm going with that. Okay. So Lawrence, as in his own strategic way, walk up to each one of them. You married? Tell them, yeah, I'm married. And go to the, you married? To the next one, all three of them, you married? Yes, they are married. Please don't do that. And then at Thad's funeral, the young lady that was driving the limousine that I was in, I'm like, Lawrence, can you leave her alone? She's 2U62. Can you leave her alone? Okay. She was a young girl. She had just graduated from college. You married? Okay. One of the things, if you lived during the 60s and 70s and even before that, you can raise your hand because we survived the era of no seat belts. Lawrence would drive, and I'm in the front seat on the edge of the seat with my little pea head self driving, but we survived no seat belts, y'all. They weren't required back then. They had them in the car, but they weren't required back then. But I survived sitting in the car with him driving, okay? Can you imagine what that was like? One funny thing, three more things. At my daddy's funeral, you know, he was on one of his little journeys, and he stood right here at my daddy's casket, just like this. Y'all remember? He was security. That's what Thad's former wife and I used to call him. We like, okay, he did that at my daddy's funeral, and we said on the program for Thad, we were gonna put Lawrence Rowell security, but if we did that, y'all probably would have left thinking, okay, somebody pop off. So we decided not to do that, but he was everybody's security. Two more things. The other thing, I remember when Lawrence went off to the Marine, when he did, y'all remember Gone with Power? Was that the name of the show? Was it Name Gone with Power? Okay, well anyway, Sergeant Carter, wasn't that the name? Okay. Well, every time I saw that, because it was a show about the Marines, I'm looking for Lawrence. Now I'm about 4 years old, seriously. I'm 4 years old, and every time it came on, Mama, I don't see Lawrence. She didn't even try to explain, but I'm looking for Lawrence. And then every time, my family is from Alabama, and every time we would go to Alabama, we passed by Fort Benning. So what was I doing? Looking for Lawrence. The soldiers out there in their formation, hey Lawrence, I'm just telling you, hey. Looking for Lawrence, thinking it's him at 4 years old. And then the last thing, mom's birthday was April 13th. And he called and was talking to her, and she passed the phone to me. And you know, he was on one of his little journeys. And he said, I want to get her something to eat. And I said, well, okay, you can go by the Chevron and get her some chicken wings. A few minutes later, y'all, get what he said. I got some weed. I said, Lawrence, I didn't say nothing about weed. Okay? I didn't say chicken wings. I didn't say weed. And please don't bring your mom weed for her birthday. Okay? Please don't do that. Please. But I told you y'all were going to laugh and see those that knew Lawrence know what I'm talking about, okay? But we love people where they are, right? His heart was right. He was going to break us up, but just not that. And I said, Lawrence, I didn't say weed. I said wings. He said, oh, I've been talking to somebody else. But anyway, just wanted to share those funny things with you. And the interesting thing, just like when Thad passed away, the Lord had me praying for our family 2 weeks before Thad died. And on May 3rd, Lawrence died on May 13th. On May 3rd, I was in prayer, and I wrote in my journal, and it's dated May 3rd. I said, Lord, I ask you to please put the perfect laborman in my mom's path and in Lawrence's path so that they don't miss heaven. All I can say is that I know that God answers prayers. We can't judge. We can't decide. We can't determine or dictate. But all I know is that God does answer prayers. Okay, so I'm going to get into the message. The last time we were here and for Thad's funeral, I did perform the eulogy as well. And the title of that message was Life Happens. And life does happen, and it happened again. It happened with Thad, it happened again, and it happens with each of you. And there are different ways and different things that we go through and experience. Because what we say now on the street is that life be life, and it's tough. It's a lot going on. And life happens because sometimes there are losses of relationships, losses of loved ones. Some people with COVID lost their houses, they lost their cars, they lost their jobs, because life be life, and as we say, they lost money. Some people are dealing with health issues. It's life be life. And then some people are still dealing with and have not dealt with the pain and the trauma of their past, childhood, different things that they have experienced, rape, molestation, and child abuse, and different things. So many things that people have not and are not dealing with. And some people are dealing with our children and their choices. How many know that when they become an adult, after 18, it's just like something happened and they just do some things and you're like, oh my gosh, that ain't how I raised you, that ain't what I thought. I trained you up in the way, but it doesn't mean they won't come back. That's the whole point. But one thing I've learned is that with our children, we cannot rescue them from everything. Sometimes we have to let them experience life so that they can realize that they need the Father. Because if we keep rescuing them, they'll look to us as the Savior. But we have to point them to the Savior. That's not for us. We have to point them to the Savior. And then one thing I say about one of mine is that they're taking the scenic route of life. And the scenic route, oh, let me go over here and let me try this. Oh, let me do this. Oh, what y'all doing over there, man? That's the scenic route. When they decide to take the scenic route of life, a route that we didn't think and that is not the best, we have to point them to the Lord and keep them on the altar and keep praying for them. The next thing, why life happens. Life happens for a couple of different reasons. Life happens because of our own sin and choices. Sometimes we go through stuff and life happens because we made some choices and did some things we had no business doing. Sometimes it's because of the sin and the choices of other people. Sometimes it had nothing to do with us, but it was other people and their choices. And then the other thing is that we live in a broken and sin-sick, fallen world. And because of that, we will experience some of life happening to us. But we're going to go to Genesis 37. And it actually, I'm going to summarize it because it's a really long, several chapters. I think it's like 13 chapters. It's really long and it has to do with Joseph. Remember Joseph with the coat of many colors. That starts in Genesis 37. And it goes through all the way through 50. But I'm going to summarize it and then I'll give you our scripture reference for today. Joseph was favored by his dad. His dad was Jacob. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Jacob was his dad. Jacob's last wife was Rachel. Rachel had two boys. She died during childbirth with the second boy, which was Benjamin. But the first one was Jacob. Joseph. Thank you so much. The first one was Joseph. And Joseph was favored by his dad because he was the first boy with the wife that he truly loved. He wanted Rachel and asked for Rachel. Thank you, Miss Green. He had a dream and he shared the dream with his brothers. He shared that they would bow down to him. Now, how do you think that was for the youngest of the family to tell the oldest that you're going to bow down to them? That didn't sit well with them. The brothers despised him. They plotted to kill him. They beat him. They threw him in a pit. So listen to how life is happening as I'm reading these things. They beat him, threw him in a pit, sold him into slavery for money, and they kept the money. And he was sent to Egypt and sold to Potiphar to work in his house. So what they did when it was time to go back to the daddy and tell the daddy what happened to his favorite son, they tore the coat. And they killed a goat and got the blood and smeared it on the coat and said that he was devoured by a wild animal. Okay, so listen to how life happened to him. But it says that the Lord was with him. Even though he was going through, the Lord was with him. Even though we go through, the Lord is with us. And it says that he was a successful man. He found favor with his master and he became the overseer of the house. The man in charge of the house and all the affairs. And he was also a good-looking man, and because of that, Potiphar's little wife decided that she wanted to entice him. And she said, come lie with me. And as he was running away, he said, no, I'm not going to do that. I respect my leader. As he was running, she tore his coat or pulled his coat and ended up on the floor. And then she basically cried rape that he tried to sleep with me and all of this stuff. So as a result, he was put in prison for something that he didn't do. So again, life happened to him. He was lied on and had to go to prison, and he was innocent. God gave Joseph the gift of dreams, being able to interpret dreams. And while he was in prison, he interpreted the dream of the butler. And the baker. And he told the butler, he said, when you get out, don't forget me. Make sure you tell them that I'm here and I'm innocent. But guess what? When the butler got out, he didn't do it. Now, much time had passed. I don't know how much, but much time had passed. And the butler finally remembered him because Potiphar had a dream. And he needed someone to interpret the dreams. The butler remembered, oh, I remember now, I remember this man in prison that can interpret dreams. So he was allowed to get out so that he can interpret the dreams. The Pharaoh really liked him and really saw him and could trust him, and God gave him favor again. And so he was allowed to get out, and then now he was in charge of all of Egypt and the food and supplies that were there. I'm getting to the end of that. Okay. So he's in charge, and he's giving everybody their food and what they need because there's a famine in the land. Guess who comes up to him in needing food? Ten brothers. Now, Benjamin, like I said, was the baby. The daddy didn't let Benjamin come because he thought that Joseph was dead. He didn't want anything to happen to Benjamin. So Benjamin had to stay. So the brothers came up. Joseph recognized them, but they didn't recognize him. He put them through a series of tests so that they could get their food. He was going to give it to them, but he put them through a series of tests. He said, bring your baby brother back. And the daddy was not happy about that, but he did let him go. He wasn't going to hurt his brother, but he said, bring your baby brother back. He brought him back and gave him everything that they needed, and he revealed himself to them. And at that point, they were so afraid because of what they had done to him. They thought he was dead, sold him into slavery. But at that point, they didn't know what to do and how he was going to respond, because being in charge, he could have had them thrown into prison or killed or whatever, but he didn't. And after all that, he did reveal himself to them, and he said, I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. They were afraid and did not know what to do. But he was reunited with them, with his father and with Benjamin. So here they are, big happy family again. In Genesis, and I forgot to get my phone, Genesis 50, 19 through 21 is the verse of scripture. We finally got to the verse of scripture. Genesis 50, 19 through 21. And it basically says that what you meant to harm me, God, turn it around for my good. Life happens, and what the enemy means to harm us, God will turn it around for our good. And he did that for him. Let me get this scripture real quick. He said, Joseph, this is Genesis 50, 19 through 21. Joseph said to them, do not be afraid, for I am in the place of God. But as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, in order to bring about as it is this day, because they needed food, and he gave it to them, as it is this day to save many people alive. Now, therefore, do not be afraid. I will provide for you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. So the title of the message today is The Power of Choices and the Power of Change. The Power of Choices, because when life happens, we can make choices in that regard. The Power of Choices and the power of change. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you that we do have an opportunity to come before you and tell you thank you, Father, and that this is the day that you have made, and we choose to rejoice in it and be glad in it, in Jesus' name. And Father God, we look to you, the author and the finisher of our faith. We ask you to be everything that we stand in need of, God. Every word that you've given me and spoken to me, God, let it plant. You said that some plant, some water, but that you give the increase, God. And I just trust you in Jesus' name, Father God, that this word will land on fertile ground, Father God, and that it will be planted and grow, and that they will hear what you're saying. I'm just a vessel, God, and I thank you for choosing me, God. But I thank you, Father God, that they will hear what you're saying and that their lives can be transformed, that they will make the choices that will bring about the necessary changes in their lives. We honor you, we bless you, and we thank you for this day and what you're doing. And we give you praise and call it done. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Just like with Joseph, life has happened to all of us, and we just talked about that. And if it hasn't, it will. Remember how old people say, just keep living? Keep living. Just keep living. But we have choices to make when life happens. Choices in regards to our health, physical health, mental health. What are we going to decide? What can we do different? Because the Bible says that faith without works is dead. We can believe God for something all day, but God is requiring things of us. There's a God part, and there's a man part, meaning that we cannot do what only he can do, and he is not going to do what he's requiring of us.
All right.
So faith without works is dead. What are you doing about it? As I shared, we talked about COVID and the different losses that people have experienced with loved ones, whether it's parents, siblings, children, losses of careers, jobs, finances, possessions, relationships. We talked about children and parenting and, you know, praying for them as they take the scenic route of life and dealing with the pain and trauma of our past. Now, Joseph wasn't the only one that experienced trouble and tragedy in life happening to him in the Bible. Jacob lost the wife that he really loved, Rachel, when she was giving birth to Benjamin. He thought he lost Joseph, but he didn't. Esau, his birthright was stolen. Ruth, she lost a husband. So as I read these, you may see where you fit in there, because we've had losses in life experiences as well. David, now David of his own choice, remember I said that some people, sometimes life happens because of sin and choices that we make. David chose to sleep with somebody else's wife. He brought the man home, lied to him, well, didn't say anything yet, put him on the front line so that he would be killed, and then tried to conceal it. That baby ended up dying. Life happened to him because of choices that he made. Job lost his children, he lost his possessions, he lost his property, and his health was attacked. Life happened to him, but God restored everything, and he got double what he lost. So God can do the same for you. Life happens to you, but it doesn't mean it's the end. The sun will shine again. Life happened to Hannah. She was barren, but she prayed, and God blessed her to have a baby. So if you're believing for something, ask God what you need to do, how you need to change, so that he can get the glory out of what you're believing for. And then Paul, again, his own choices, he chose to persecute Christians, but God allowed him to be knocked down off of a horse, blinded him, but he became one of the greatest men of the New Testament, but his own sin and choices, but then he chose the way of the Father. So the power of choices and the power of change. Okay, so I'm gonna tell you a quick story. I'm not gonna be long, almost done. There was a person that enlisted in the armed forces, and the soldier did really, really well and was easily promoted. But while serving their country, they suffered physical abuse and possibly some other forms of abuse from fellow soldiers and possibly superior officers. To anyone, this would be mentally and emotionally taxing and traumatic to have to deal with that. This trauma and abuse took a toll on them, and they became abusive and disregarding to those in their families and around them. And in their own way, this was their own way of venting their anger and their frustration. Because of a series of events, they were discharged from the military. Some could possibly see this as an opportunity for God to get the glory and as an opportunity to ultimately fulfill their life dream of becoming a lawyer and perhaps represent and advocate those that went through the same thing that they did. There are maybe so much more pain and trauma that we don't even know about them, but that person is none other than Lawrence Franklin Rowell. We don't know. He wasn't vocal. We didn't grow up being vocal and being able to share. But we don't know all that he endured. And I believe he did the best that he could. So again, the power of choices and the power of change. The lessons that I've learned over the years is that a person can only give you what they have. They can't give you any more than that. And sometimes we have expectations of what people should do, what they could do. But a person can only give you what they have, and they can't give you any more than that. Sometimes less, but they can't give you any more than what they have. Our responsibility, another thing that I've learned, is that our responsibility is to love people unconditionally where they are. With that agape God kind of love, that unconditional love, that's what God requires of us. Another thing that I've learned is that the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 5:18, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. So when we go through and when life happens, it doesn't mean that God has left us. How do you give thanks in a situation such as this, to lose two brothers? How do you give thanks in that? You know why? Because I know who God is. I know that God is in control. And I know that God will fix everything concerning me. And he will do the same for you. So in the midst of it, you tell God, thank you. You don't thank God that the person died, but in the midst of the going through, God, I thank you that I will watch you be everything that I need to be, that you will comfort me, that you will wipe every tear from my eye. Oh, yeah. Just as Pastor said, weeping may endure for a night, but joy does come in the morning. The fourth thing that I learned is forgiveness. It's tough sometimes to forgive when we've been hurt. But guess what? You too have hurt people. And a lot of times people that are holding unforgiveness forget that they have been forgiven and that they want God to forgive them. The Bible says to forgive and you shall be forgiven. And the last thing that I learned is to take responsibility for our actions and what we have done or need to do. A lot of times we like to point fingers, they did this, they didn't do this, but take responsibility for what we did or did not do. And then lastly, to obey God at all costs. Do what God said, but how are you gonna know what it said? He said if you don't get in his word. We gotta get in his word. Even if you have a busy life, listen to it on audio Bible. You can still get the word. And then to my nephews. You may not have had what you needed and who you needed, but God is able. He'll fix every broken place in you. And he will be everything that you stand in need of. Amen. He's wanting
you to say yes to him. He's wanting your surrender to him so that he can have his way in your life, because what you don't want is for your children to have to do what you did today in this way. God is calling you higher. He has expectations of you. He has plans for you. But you will only know the plans if you surrender your life to him. He's waiting for you. He loves each of you unconditionally. God knew the whole situation when you were born. He knew it. He was not surprised. But he is the answer, and he is the way. He's waiting for you. Derek, Tron, LaFarris, he is waiting with open, outstretched arms. That was his work on the cross for times such as this, for today. He did it just for y'all. He had you in mind. He said, I know the plans that I have for you, said the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but he will deliver us out of them all. Fix it, God. Wipe every tear in the name of Jesus. Do it, God. Show them who you are. Reveal yourself to them. Thank you, Father. We bless you, Lord. But one thing about God, he won't pour himself on us. He wants us to choose him. He said, choose ye this day whom you will serve. You have no control over the hand that you were dealt. You have no control over the hand that you were dealt. But you do have control over how you play the hand. For y'all that play spades, it's just a card game, it's not seen. Y'all know y'all get a bad hand. But guess what? Those bad hands won sometimes, didn't they? You have no control over the hand that you were dealt, but you do have control over how you play the hand. Life may give you lemons, but guess what? You make lemonade with it. You find the sweet in it. Because God said that, I've heard that people say that there is always good amid the bad. God never wastes a hurt. He never wastes anything that we go through. He never wastes any thing that we experience. He never wastes any trial, any trouble that we have. He doesn't waste it. It's for him to get the glory. But guess what? You can get the victory, but you make the choice. The power of choices and the power of change. And for the rest of you, as I share, life has happened to all of us. Some of you may be saying, God, I'm afraid. I have fear, God. I need you, Lord. But your Bible says, God, that you have not given me a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and of a sound mind. I'm struggling, God. Show me how, Father God. Show me how to trust you. You said in Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, to trust you with all of my heart and to lean not to my own understanding, but in all of my ways to acknowledge you, and you will direct my path. But God, I'm having problems trusting you. Lord, help me. Please help me, Lord. I need you. Father, you told us to give you thanks and praise anyway, but I'm having problems with that, God. I'm struggling, God. Lord, help me. I need you.
Father God, you said in your word, you said, Father God, that you who have begun a good work in us shall complete it until the day of Christ, God. I can't see, Father God, my way. Lord, help me. I need you. Father God, you said in your word to not grow weary in well-doing. For in due season we shall reap if we faint not. But God, I'm getting weary and I'm about to faint. Lord, help me. I need you, Lord. We've been made endure for a night, but joy does come in the morning. You said in Matthew 11, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Lord, I'm struggling. Please help me, Lord. I need you. You said, Father God, that I can look to you, the author and the finisher of my faith. But God, my faith is growing faint. You told me, God, to walk by faith and not by sight. I can't see my way, God. Lord, help me. I need you, Lord. Show up for me, Lord. Reveal yourself to me, Lord. Father, help me. I need you, Lord. I stand in the need of prayer right now, God. There is nothing that is too hard for you, God. That's what your word says. That's what the theologian said, God. But Lord, help me. I need you, Lord. I need you, Father. You told me to tell you thank you for everything, God. But I'm having problems with it, Lord. Help me, Father. I need you, Lord. Show up for me, Lord. Speak to me, Lord. In the midnight hour, Father God, when I'm crying, Father God, for those that may say their bodies are racking with pain, touch my body, because you said in your word that I worship above all things, that you may be in health, and that you may prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers in the name of Jesus. Lord, help me. I need you, Lord. I stand in the need of power. I need you, God. Jesus, Father God, there is none like you, God. You said you knew the plans that you have for me, plans to prosper me and not harm me, God. But I'm having problems seeing that. Lord, help me. Say it with me, Lord. Say it with me, y'all. Lord, help me. I need you. Lord, help me. I need you. Come on, y'all. Lord, help me. I need you, God. When the tears are streaming down.
You're right. what you say when life happens and when you're going through. Invite God in your situation. Invite God in what you're going through. And he'll fix it and he'll turn it around. I am a living witness. That's the kind of God that we serve. He's not going to override your will. He wants you to invite him. You don't go to a party that you're not invited. So God wants you to invite him. Not only in your situation, but in your life. So if there's anybody here today that has not accepted the Lord as your personal Savior, he said, don't be ashamed to own me on earth. Because if you're ashamed to own me on earth, I'm going to be ashamed to own you in heaven. So this is your opportunity. The Bible says that today is the day of salvation. Pardon my part. So if there's any of you that want to accept the Lord in your life, into your heart, so that he can begin the good work in you, because what you want at the end of the day is for him to say, well done. You don't want him to say, depart from me, because you rejected him. You want him to say, well done. So if there's anybody today, don't ever be ashamed. This is your opportunity.
Thank you. Bethel sympathy. The pastor, the officers, and members of Big Bethel Missionary Baptist Church unites in expressing our deepest sympathy for the passing of your loved one. Your loved one has departed this life and will be sadly missed by all, for it is God's way and His will must be done. May this tribute of respect bear some comfort to you, the relatives and friends of this deceased family member, with fond hope of a happy reunion. If we do the will of our Father, we will meet beyond the river, where we will part no more. In the fellowship of this faith, we extend a loving hand of sympathy and understanding, presented this 18th day of May 2024, Pastor Rod Hubbard, Reverend Associate Minister Reverend Charles Miller. Yourself in the love and warmth that this blanket